Good morning, good morning, good morning, and welcome to Eastborough Church of the Nazarene. We're so glad that you are all here and seeing the smiling faces and the talking and the laughter. It is a true joy to hear it all. We're so glad that you're here. Let's go ahead and pray. Heavenly Father, we just thank you for this beautiful day that you've blessed us with. We thank you for being here with each and every one of us. Father, we pray that all that takes place today is to glorify you and lift your name on high. May we just love on each other and remember why we're here, Lord. Help us throughout the week. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Well, this morning we're thinking about things that are kind of weighing heavy on our hearts. Drew Romero having this major accident, having a brain bleed, the spleen repair, and the family being separated, or we're thinking about loved ones that we've lost. Mrs. Shim yesterday at 1:45 went to be with her Savior, went to be with the Lord, and others who have had folks pass recently, like the Rose family, Kathy, and Wayne, and these things can really weigh on us. But something that we do know is that our God, He is an awesome God, and He has provided the ways of salvation and the way of comfort for our lives. Amen. He has a way of intervening for us, and He gives us the hope of heaven if we will believe in His Son, our Lord Jesus. Amen. And we can have confidence that, you know, like Jesus told I think it was Martha, that the person who believes in Him, though that person die, that person will live. Amen? Amen. We have an awesome God, and we can praise Him today. And so let's do that. Will you stand to your feet, and we're going to sing There's No One Like Our God. What is this love that won't relent? It's calling down with heaven's breath. Who's reaching wide to save our souls? Only you. What is this grace that makes no sense? That we could never recompense? Who gives us all a second chance? Only you, only you, only you. There is no one like our God. There is no one like our God. There is no other God who can save. There is no one like our God.
Who is like our God? Who saves like He does? Who hung up the stars upon the night
and showed the sun how bright to shine? Who shaped the world in His hands? Only you. Who set the sky upon the hills and told the waters to be still? Who spoke the form of the universe? Only you, only you, only you. There is no one like our God.
Sing it to Him with all your heart.
There is no one like our God. There.
Stand between us,
power on earth or all creation. No life or death can separate us from your love.
Do you believe that?
Yes. No height or depth can stand between us. No power on earth or all creation. No life or death can separate us from your love. There is no one like our God. There is no one like our God. There is no other God who can save. There is no one like our God. There is no one like our God. There is no other God who can save. There is no one like our God. There is no other God who can save. There is no one like our God.
Amen. You may be seated, but is there any other God like our God? No, there is no other God like our God. Who would give his own son to save us who are steeped in sin? Who were going down towards everlasting fire, and he let his son die on the cross in our place. Amen? There is no other God like our God. And today, as we grieve these losses, as today as we think about Drew and the Romero family, folks, there is no God like our God. Amen? Who brings to everlasting life, who saves and intervenes and heals. Well, we want to welcome all of you this morning. I want to remind you what our mission is at Eastborough. It's to transform lives by making Christ-like disciples wherever we go. We join together so that God can turn us upside down, right? So we can turn the world upside down. Well, what does that mean? See, we gather together so that we will be more like Christ and be transformed into the image of Jesus Christ, so that we will then take that image out into a world that doesn't know about Jesus so that they can hear about him and experience the same hope that we have and the same salvation that we have. Amen? Well, we are glad that everybody's here today. I want to welcome you guys who are here for the first time in one of our worship services. You've been here for Vacation Bible School before, but we're really glad to welcome you guys. On your bulletin, okay, pull these things out, you guys, all right? We kind of communicate, right, at Eastborough through these paper bulletins. We're actually allowed to have them now. And we also communicate through Facebook. And so if you want to connect with what's going on at the church, just look up Eastborough Church of the Nazarene on Facebook. And we would love for you guys to share your contact information, any prayer requests that anybody has right here. And whenever we take the offering, the offering plates are right over there in the back and over there. And just put your prayer requests, anything that you want to communicate to us in the offering plates together with your offering there. I want to give some thank yous. Well, a big thank you for our family. Whenever we had our restoration celebration for being back totally in this building again, you guys gave us a tremendous gift, and that was really, really overwhelming that you would bless us that way. And so I just want to thank our church for doing that for us. We didn't deserve that. We're just doing the work of the Lord, but you guys chose to bless us, and I just want to thank you for blessing us. About Mrs. Shim. Mrs. Shim, again, yesterday at 1:45 in the afternoon, she went into the presence of her Savior. And it was a real hard fight at the end, but she's with Christ now. Amen? They're planning to have a service on the 10th. They're thinking at 10 o'clock in the morning. I don't know if that's totally established yet, but on July 10th at 10 o'clock in the morning. So write that down and remember that. Also, Eve Ramsey's memorial service, the family invites you. Her service will be on the 3rd at 5 o'clock in the afternoon, okay? So this coming Saturday, 5 o'clock, we're going to be meeting together to bless this family and to help them. Anybody who can be a help in breaking everything down afterwards so that we can have the service ready the next morning, I know that that will be appreciated. The Ramsey family will appreciate that. Rich will appreciate that so that we can have everything ready to go for worship service Sunday morning. But please join the Ramseys. Eve fought an intense fight, and but she's with the Lord now, and we're going to celebrate her life. The family said, we want this to be a celebratory service, and Eve wanted this to be a celebratory service about God's grace, so be here for that. Also, children's camp. Those who are going to have kids going to children's camp, you need to be here at noon tomorrow morning, okay? Noon is the time. And we have to get up to camp, but we get together to leave at noon. So don't miss out on that. And then I need some helpers. Eric and Hannah and Sarah, if you'll come up here. We need to invite our friends and our family members and the children of co-workers. And so put one of some of these in everybody's hands, okay? Yeah, put a few in their hands. So Vacation Bible School is going to be July 12th from the 16th from 6 to 8 p.m. And it's for children from 4 to 12 years old. If older kids want to help, then they will be assigned a position to help with, okay? So, but we need your help. And it's been an interesting thing. Two of the principal workers for our Vacation Bible School have things happening, right? Drew Romero was writing all the lessons for Vacation Bible School, and now he's had this terrible accident, and he's not going to be able to help with Vacation Bible School. My wife, Seda, will be going in for surgery July 7th, and so she's not going to be able to help with Vacation Bible School. And you know what? Sometimes Satan tries to pound and pound and pound when we're doing something for him, right? But folks, let's rally and let's do a work for Jesus Christ. Does that sound good? Let's do a work for the Lord so that some children will get to know Jesus as their Lord, as the leader of their life, and as their Savior. So be ready for those things that are happening. Give these to your friends and your family members. If you take a picture of it, you can put it on your Facebook, or you can link to our link at the church's Facebook, but invite somebody for that. Last announcement. Sometimes when we're worn out because of everything that's happened, it's good for us to praise with the people of God. And this afternoon, they're doing a worship service for churches of the Nazarene all around the world. We're in 174 countries, Linda. And so there's going to be participants from people all around the world for this celebration of grace. You'll see the information, how you can log on to this worship service. Sadie and I were watching it last night because they started it, you know, on the other time zone on the other side of the world. And they're just doing it again and again. You can see it multiple times throughout the day. So become a part of your global family and participate in that worship service. Well, I'm all out of breath. We're going to have our time of offering and tithes, and may God bless that. And Aaron Stoltzfus, will you come up and pray for that?
Let's pray. Father God, we're so grateful to be here this morning. And we thank you for this time that we can give of our money to bless others and to be involved in the things that are happening here with the local community. We have Vacation Bible School coming up, and we pray that as we need workers, and as things have happened to some of our workers, we just pray, Lord, that you would meet those needs. And we thank you, Lord, that you are meeting our needs. And I just pray that we keep God's work in mind as we give, that we would be cheerful givers, and that we would give as unto you, so others can know about Jesus. And there are places around the world that have never had God's word as of today. And we just pray that as we give to you, that people would be able to find God's word, and that they would become your servants. And we thank you, Lord, that we can have eternal life through Jesus. And we're so grateful for that. And I'm grateful today that for the service that we can have today. And I pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Well, I want to thank my two helpers today. I've known them both for a long time. And I'm just thankful they're here. Kathy, during this time, is running back and forth and taking care of all kinds of stuff. And it's a very exhausting time as she takes care of everything for her brother who passed away. And so continue to pray for her. But at least I get to stand by two beauties during worship. So stand up to your feet and sing unto the Lord. Amazing grace. It's been his grace, amen. Stand to your feet and let's sing Amazing Grace. We are saved by grace. It's not by works, amen. He has made us his workmanship, and we take that grace to the world.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now am found. Was blind, but now I see. 'Twas grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fear.
Like a flood,
The earth shall soon dissolve like snow. The sun forbear to shine, but God who called me here below will be forever mine, will be forever.
Forever ours, because you gave your son. Our names are now written on the palms of his hands, and it is by his grace that we have been saved. We've been saved from the power of Satan and sin and death. We have been saved from the downward spiral of this world and its values. And we bless you today. We thank you that because of you, Jesus, today we can die knowing that physical death is not the end. Life remains for us who believe in Jesus Christ. And so we exalt in you. We thank you, oh God, that today we know that you dwell within, that you are the one who gives us the strength and the ability to continue in this walk with you, Lord Jesus. It is a walk where you require us to pick up our cross, to die to ourselves, and to follow you. It is a walk that is not easy because, Jesus, you yourself said, in this world, you will have afflictions. But, Lord, we know it is a promise through Jesus, too, that you have overcome the world. And because you have overcome the world, we have overcome the world. Lord, we think of that power operating in our lives, and we think of Drew Romero, Lord, and we ask that you put your mighty hand of healing upon him. Lord, we ask in Jesus' name that you would open the floodgates of heaven and that you would pour out your spirit upon Drew, that you would stop this brain bleed, oh God, that you would heal where they've done surgery, that you will strengthen up his ribs, Lord God, as they get ready to do this second surgery, oh God, that you will guide the hands of the doctors and nurses, but most of all, Lord, you know him better, and you have all the power, and you can heal, and we ask that you do so in Jesus' name. Lord, we also think of people who are hurting over their loved one, Mr. Shim and his family. And Lord, I hadn't seen Mr. Shim cry. And this week, this last week, I saw him weep. And Lord, I ask that you would intervene for that family. I ask that you would intervene for Kathy Rose, her sister, Lord God, as they ache over the loss of Danny. And then the Ramsey family, as they hurt over the loss of Eve. Lord, we beg your intervention for them. Your word tells us that you're the God of all comfort, and that you can come up alongside of us through your Holy Spirit, and you can comfort us in our afflictions. And then you can even use that affliction and that comforting to someday help someone else in theirs. Lord, I ask that you would give them hope in these days. We thank you for your word that says that you are near to the brokenhearted, that you save those who are crushed in spirit. Thank you for the hope that we have too, that these who have put their trust in Jesus Christ, they're with the Lord now. They're with the Lord. They have a victory that they knew that they never imagined that they could have, beyond their wildest imagination. And Lord, we thank you for that. And we thank you for the hope that one day, all of us who have lost loved ones who were in Christ, one day, Jesus, at your return, when the trumpet sounds, when the archangel shouts, The dead in Christ will rise first, and then we who remain behind will be caught up with them in the air. And so we praise you and we bless you for that. Lord, we also are thinking of the things that are coming up. Children's camp tomorrow. We ask that all, we're happy that the kids are going to have fun. And we ask for safety and fun for them. But more than anything, way beyond safety and fun, Lord Jesus, is that they would have an encounter with you. That your Spirit would speak to their hearts, going deep into their hearts, helping them to be convicted of sin and of righteousness, of judgment. Oh God, convince them that through Jesus Christ, they too can be saved. Lord, we ask that you do the same thing in our vacation Bible school. Seems like Satan's pounding against it, but Lord, you have good news. Because our hope and our defense is you. And we don't trust in chariots and swords. We don't trust in armies nearly as much or anywhere close to us trusting in the Lord our God. And we are trusting that you are going to give us workers. That we are trusting that you are going to give us strength. We are trusting that you're going to intervene as we all start inviting friends and family. Lord, we just ask that you would do a work. And we trust that you will. And we put all these things today in your hands. Lord, we think of those who are struggling financially. We think of those who are struggling with work, housing. Lord, we ask that you provide for it all as Jehovah Jireh. We ask too then those who are struggling also with other sicknesses, pains. Lord, we ask that the oil of your Spirit descend upon each of them and do a healing work. We ask it all in Jesus' name. Amen. 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 God is good. Well, at the end of the service today, Pastor Bailey is going to be leading us through communion. I want you to know that at the Church of the Nazarene, we practice open communion. Anyone who has turned away from sin and has put their trust in Jesus Christ, has believed on him as their Lord and Savior, you're welcome to take communion with us today. I want you to turn in your Bibles to Ezekiel 36. We're continuing to talk about what God does when he has a bad rap, right? We've been talking about how he sanctifies his name. But now we're going to talk about how he sanctifies his name. So go ahead and turn with me, Ezekiel chapter 36. We're going to be in verses 23 and 24 today. And will you stand to your feet out of reverence for the Lord and his word? Ezekiel chapter 36, verses 23 and 24. It says here in the New American Standard Bible, "I will vindicate the holiness of my great name, which has been profaned among the nations, which you have profaned in their midst. Then the nations will know that I am the Lord, declares the Lord God, when I prove myself holy among you in their sight. For I will take you from the nations, gather you from all the lands, and bring you into your own land." Let's pray. Lord, we ask that you would help us today as we meditate upon your word. Lord, help us to really ask ourselves if we're in a far off land. And we need to be restored to the place of promise and this place of presence. Do your work within us. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated. So we've been talking about how God had gotten a bad rap from his own people, right? They, because of their own poor behavior, because of their own disobedience, because they were worshiping idols, God had to send them off into far-off lands in exile, in discipline for that poor behavior. When they went off into those far-off lands, the other nations began to doubt about the goodness and the might of God, about his covenant faithfulness. All the nations began to doubt about that. They said, "These are the children of God, and God has let them come out of their land. What kind of God could he possibly be? He must be a weak God. He must be a God who breaks faithfulness. a God who doesn't really love. And so God had gotten a bad rap. But God says, I want to do something. In here, it says, I'm going to prove the holiness of my great name. In other translations, it says, I'm going to sanctify my great name. What does that mean? He's going to prove himself to be like no other God. He's going to demonstrate that he is God and there is no other. He is going to vindicate his holiness. He is going to make the whole world gawk at himself and his power. You know what gawking is? Have you ever gawked before? I've gawked before, right? Whenever I've seen something awesome, I'll just like, oh my. Okay, that's gawking, okay? Your eyes are wide open. Your jaw's kind of dropped. And you're just amazed at just what happened, right? You ever seen that? Some it might be with seeing their first Trans Am, right? But this is way bigger than that, isn't it? This is when people see God and see God at work. They may not physically see him, but they perceive that he is at work and they are in wonder and amazement. Their hearts are fearing because of who God is. And he says that he is going to sanctify himself. He's going to do that amongst the people of God. These people who have been rebellious and disobedient and idolatrous, that he's going to do a work. Now, I want you to remember, these were the people of God who had been disobedient and rebellious and idolatrous. And he says, I'm going to do something so great in you that all the nations, the non-Israelites, the non-Jews, they are going to gawk and be amazed. I want you to think about that. He said, when I prove myself holy among you, in their sight. That among you means in you, because of you, through you. So that when people see what I'm doing in you as the people of God, when they see what I'm doing through you, when they see what I'm doing because of you, they're going to be amazed. That's when they're going to gawk. Now some people we'll kind of say, you know, in the South, they'll say, quit gawking at me. Right? Quit your gawking. But there's sometimes when you're supposed to gawk, right? The world is supposed to gawk at us and what God does among us and in us because of us and through us. The world is supposed to gawk. They're supposed to be, oh my word. My, oh my. Right? So I'm getting a little bit of my dad's Oklahoma accent today. But that is what's supposed to happen. Because God is demonstrating his amazing grace through his people. He's going to show himself to really be like no other God and truly the only God through us. Well, how does he do that? And today's the first point of how he does that. It's in verse 24. In verse 24, he tells us exactly how he's going to do it. He says, first part, this is how I'm going to show the world that there's no one like me. I will take you from the nations, gather you from all the lands, and bring you into your own land. Now, they were in all the nations. They were amongst all the peoples and lands because of their own bad behavior. They were under Nebuchadnezzar's empire. They were under all that Nebuchadnezzar had defeated before. So they were under what had been the Assyrian empire also. They were under all these folks that had taken them as slaves, as prisoners. And God says, I'm going to bring you out. God says, I'm going to do something that they would have never expected. I am going to take you from the nations, gather you from all the lands, and bring you into your own land. So we know their predicament. It's a pretty bad predicament, isn't it? they're kind of stuck. They're under the dominion of foreigners who do not know about God, who don't care about God. They're under their strong arm, their iron fist. And God says, I am going to take you out. I want to take you from the nations. I want you to think about that. What does that mean? You know, whenever you just take something, right? We kind of sometimes think of just grabbing something. Well, here he says, I'm going to take you in my hand and I'm going to carry you along. I want to take you out of there and I'm going to carry you away. Okay? How many of you have ever dealt with a child or a grandchild who you just needed to take into your arms and take somewhere else so that that child would feel safe or that grandchild would feel comforted? Okay? It's like you take it to yourself and then you go. When he says he's going to take them from out of the nations, that's the kind of wordage it is. Okay? He's going to take them from those nations, those territories, those governments where they had been in exile, and he's going to take them from the nations. Oh, goodness. Isn't it an amazing thing when God takes us? I like that picture because sometimes we can see God, God's going to take us. We can see him with a big whip, and he's angry with us, and right? No, that's not the picture that we see. We see the picture of these people, even though they've been bad, even though they've misbehaved and been idolatrous and rebellious, I'm going to take you in my arms out of the nations. And the nations are going to know that I'm God. When I do that, he says also, I'm going to gather you from all the lands. I'll gather you from all the lands and bring you into your own land. The idea there, again, though, is now it intensifies a little bit. If you look through the Old Testament, whenever they used the word gather, it was when they were going to like gather troops and gather a big group of people. Okay? Gather and organize troops. And so they were going to kind of be mustered from out of all these lands. And if you look at the history of Israel, that's exactly what happened. They were mustered, right? Out of Babylon. They were mustered out of the Medo-Persian Empire. They were mustered from all these places and gathered together. Now, God, though, is gathering this time to reoccupy the land. Okay, so he's taking them in his arms, but he's gathering them together so they can retake the land, their own land. Previously, okay, in prophecy, God gathers them for wrath, for punishment. Okay, if you go back to Ezekiel 22:19-22. It says, therefore, thus said the Lord God, because all of you have become dross, therefore, behold, I am going to gather you in the midst of Jerusalem. And as they gather silver and bronze and iron and lead and tin into the furnace to blow fire on it, and in order to melt it, I will gather you in my anger and in my wrath, and I will lay you there and melt you. I will gather you and blow on you with the fire of my wrath, and you will be melted in the midst of it. This is a totally different gathering, isn't it? See, God had gathered them previously for exile because they had been disobedient and idolatrous and rebellious. He says, now I'm not going to gather you for that anymore. I want to gather you for something else. If you would read in Deuteronomy chapter 30, verses 2 through 4, it talks about how God promised if they would turn to him and seek his face, that he would gather them. Right? Look at what it says there. Deuteronomy 30, 2 through 4 says this. If you return to the Lord your God and obey him with all your heart and soul, according to all that I command you today, you and your sons, then the Lord your God will restore you from the captivity and have compassion on you and will gather you again from all the peoples where the Lord your God has scattered you. If you're outcasts at the end of the earth, from there the Lord your God will gather you, and from there he will bring you back. Now, that's a different kind of gathering, isn't it? That's the kind of gathering that Ezekiel's talking about. In Ezekiel 20:41, it says, as a soothing aroma, I will accept you when I bring you out from the peoples and gather you from the lands where you are. And I will prove myself holy among you in the sight of the nations. God, see, he's into gathering us from the far off lands. But sometimes I wonder if, we're kind of like them. They're the people of God, but they're in the far off lands. Can we today sometimes be the people of God, but in far off lands? They were in far off lands because of their uncleanness, right? There were different kinds of uncleanness in the Old Testament. There could be the kind of uncleanness that was sexual perversion. There could be the kind of uncleanness that was just like if somebody had mold in their house. But whatever that uncleanness was, it separated them from God. Whatever that uncleanness was, it took them to a far-off land. Sometimes I wonder if we can have the uncleanness of bitterness in our hearts, right? It takes us to a far-off land. Even though we come to church every Sunday morning, right, or come to church on Wednesday nights, even though we preach from pulpits, we can be in a far-off land. Sometimes can there be a far-off land and you're there just because of unfaithfulness? You've really just stopped believing in the Lord. You just stopped trusting in him. You stopped trusting his promises. You don't really trust that he's a good God anymore, and so you're in a far-off land. Now, people in your life, they can see it because your faith is waning. And your fervor has depleted terribly, right? You're in a far-off land. Could we be in a far-off land maybe because of idolatry? I'll be honest with you. Sometimes I'm tempted to think, well, Lord, you're supposed to entertain me good and make me comfortable and make me be able to have a trip to Mazatlan every year, right? I haven't been there yet, but I want to. And we start kind of worshiping the comforts and the entertainments. Hey, Rich, if you guys could get some air on in here, is anybody else hot? I'm just wondering. You're good? Okay. All right, I just want to be sure, because I sometimes want to start sleeping too. Just because of how hot it is. But it must be the lights for me. But we're in kind of a far-off land because we've kind of decided that giving our lives to Jesus is about getting comforts and getting entertainments and having prosperity and wealth and those kind of things. And the church ends up being in a far-off land. You see, in a far-off land, you don't have the presence of God, right? The promised land was where God dwelt. You don't have the blessing of God. The promised land was where God gardened it himself. He made milk and honey flow. He did that in the promised land. And they were far off from that. The promised land is where they met with him and had communion with him. And they're far away from that. And sometimes I wonder that if in the church, we're not seeing the evidences of his presence, we're not seeing the evidences of his blessing, if we're not seeing the evidences of communion with God, maybe we're in a far-off land. Could we be in a far-off land? And God's saying, I want to gather you to myself. I mustered you before for wrath and for punishment because of this, but now I want to bring you out of those far-off lands because of your idolatry, because of your uncleanness. I want to bring you out of there and show the nations I can redeem a people. They have my name but appear so far away from me. This is kind of a hard sermon to hear, isn't it? I have to first and foremost preach it to myself. I wonder, too, if there can be other kinds of far-off lands, like the far-off land of politics. You know, we think God will move in our nation if we just get the right president and the right governor and the right this, that, or the other. And the church lacks power and influence because somehow we have lifted on high politicians. You think of the early church. Weren't they experiencing God's presence and his promises and his power in an awesome way? Were pretty much any of the politicians in their favor? No. They weren't. And I wonder, Lord, maybe we just need to be gathered. We need to be mustered together. And we need to be restored. He said, I will bring you back to the promised land, right? I'll bring you in. End of verse 24. It says that I will bring you into your own land. I'll bring you. That thought there is, I'm going to lead you in. I'm going to carry you in. I'm going to cause you to come in. God himself can make his people gather in. He can carry them back. And he can cause them to have the same communion, the same presence, the same blessings, the same promises that they had. In some versions of the Bible, when you read Acts chapter 2, the title says, the ingathering. The ingathering. The idea is that 120, right, were gathered in. They started out as about 18. It was the 11 disciples and Jesus' brothers and his mother and the women that had traveled from Galilee. It's about 18 people. Within days, they had more. Right? They had 120. And God gathered them in. I wonder if God doesn't need to gather some of us in. Huh? Maybe he needs to gather us in the church back to him. And he needs to bring us back. You know, the words bring back, those are the very same words. Same Hebrew word that God used when Abraham entered the promised land for the first time. It says in Genesis chapter 12, verse 5, it says, Abraham took his wife Sarai, his nephew Lot, all the possessions they had accumulated, and the people that they had acquired in Haran, and they set out for the land of Canaan, and they arrived there. That word, they arrived there, means that they were brought there. Okay? They were brought there. Okay? Abraham then travels through the land as far as the site of the great tree of Moreh at Shechem. At that time the Canaanites were in the land. The Lord appeared to Abraham and said, to your offspring I will give this land. See, when God brings us, he brings us into promise. He brings us into promise. There's all kinds of promises, right? And maybe we need to be brought back to those promises. The promise of salvation, that He works, not according to us that we would like, but the salvation that He would work. Maybe we need to be brought back to His presence and communion with Him. Maybe we need to be brought back to where we find our fulfillment and our satisfaction in God. I want to ask you today, are you in a far-off land? Are you in a far-off land of maybe bitterness because of what people did or what God did, what God allowed? Yeah, in a far-off land where church has become about you rather than Him? Are you in a far-off land? God's wanting to show how amazing and how awesome He is by bringing you home. How many of you guys are amazed at the story of the prodigal son? Any of you? You remember that? Anybody who's been a prodigal and who's come back to God, they're amazed by it. And you think of the prodigal son said, "Give me all that that's owed to me for my inheritance." And then he goes off to a far-off land and he squanders it all. His older brother says that he squanders it on prostitutes and wild living. And finally comes to the point of being so broken, he's in a pig pen. And it says that he's longing to eat the pods that the pigs were eating. He comes to his senses then, though, and he says, "I'll rise and I'll go to my father. I'll tell my father, 'Father, I've sinned against heaven, I've sinned against you. I'm no longer worthy to be called your son. Let me be one of your servants.'" And so off he went. But I want you to think about the father. The father, it says he was watching the horizon for the arrival of his son. When he saw him, he ran to his son. It says that he embraced his son, kissed him on the neck, that he said, "Get the best robe for my son. Get the family ring for his finger. Get sandals on his feet. Kill the fatted calf because we're going to celebrate. For my son who is dead is alive." He'll later tell his older brother, "My son who was lost has been found." That's kind of how God brings us home. You know, at the end of this, the Lord will say, "You need to recognize what you did. You need to mourn over your sin." But God, if we will do that, He is waiting. And if we're in a far-off land, it's time for us to come to our senses as a church. It's time for us to come to our senses as individuals and know that there's a Father that's waiting. There's a Father that will run to us not to punish us, but to embrace us and to redeem us and to restore us. Will you let Him gather you to Himself today? Will you let Him bring you home? Will you let Him bring you home? You're going to be brought home by a more awesome God. And when you're brought home, the world's going to know it. Your family and friends, your co-workers, your kids, they're going to know it. So as we take communion today, before you take communion, I want you to ask you, are you at home in the arms of the Lord? Has He shown how awesome He is through your life and what He's done in you? Pray about that. Bow your heads, close your eyes. Oh Father, oh Lord Jesus, oh Spirit of living God, we We want the world to know how awesome you are, how good you are. Sometimes through us, sometimes through me, the world's gotten given you a bad rap. Because they haven't seen the nature of God in me. And they haven't seen the nature of God in some of us. Oh Lord, as we get ready to take the bread, as we get ready to take the cup, oh God, may it be our way today. Maybe some of us just say, I'm coming home. I'm coming home. Gather me to yourself, Lord. Bring me to the place of promise. Bring me to that place where you are present. Bring me back to true blessing, true spiritual blessing. Bring me home to you. I want communion with you again. Do your work now, we pray. In Jesus' name. Pastor Bailey.
In the Church of the Nazarene, we practice an open communion. This means that anyone is welcome to take communion. It is not our table, but the Lord's table. The Lord himself ordained this holy sacrament. He commanded his disciples to partake of the bread and the wine, tokens of his broken body and shed blood. This is his table. The feast is for his disciples. Let all who have with true repentance forsaken their sins and have believed in Christ unto salvation draw near and take these tokens, and by faith partake in the life of Jesus Christ to your soul's comfort and joy. Let us remember that it is a memorial of the death and the passion of our Lord, also a token of his coming again. Let us not forget that we are at the table with the Lord. It's important for us to be able to come to the table with a clean, pure heart, and to be able to come to this table in thanksgiving. So I would encourage you, I'll give you a few moments. Take some time and pray to God. Pray for confession of sins and thank God for this table that he is setting for us. So I would encourage you to take a few moments and pray. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, who out of your teacher and tender mercy gave your only Son, Jesus Christ, to suffer death upon the cross for our redemption. Grant that as you receive this of your creatures of bread and wine, according to the holy institution of your Son, Savior, Jesus Christ, in remembrance of his passion and death, we may be made partakers of the benefits of his anointing sacrifice. We may come to you before you in true humility and faith as we partake in this holy sacrament through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. So I would, at this point, invite our people who are distributing the elements. No? hear the words from Paul in 1 Corinthians chapter 11. For I have received from the Lord what also passed on to you. On the night when he was betrayed, the Lord Jesus took bread. And when he had given thanks, broke it and said, "This is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, he also took the cup after supper and said, "This cup is the new covenant of my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes again." This is the word of the Lord. So take the bread, and this is the body of our Lord Jesus Christ, which is broken for you, to preserve you blameless unto everlasting life. Take and eat this in remembrance that Christ has died for you. The blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, which was shed for you, preserve you blameless unto everlasting life. Drink this in remembrance that Christ's blood was shed for you, and be thankful. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, I thank you for your sacrifice and for what you did on the cross. And we know that we only come to this table by your name, and it's only by you that we are made whole and complete. I thank you for your table, and that we have come to partake in you with thanksgiving. I pray all these things in your name. Amen.
Well, I hope that you've come home today. Amen? Amen? I hope that you've let him gather you in and you go home reconciled to the Lord. And may the whole world see it through us. Amen? Amen. May the whole world see it through us. Amen? All right. Well, before I dismiss you, we still have some Father's Day gifts from last week. Some of you dads didn't get them. Karen, if you'll stand. And I want you to see Karen, because she has a special gift for you. You are dismissed. God bless you. And go out, and may the world see Jesus, see the Lord through you.